Good morning, folks.
Good morning.
I'm a new face, aren't I? My name is Keith Enko. I'm a retired pastor. The last 18 years has been in Hermitage, Tennessee, which is the close, around about 15 minutes outside of Nashville. So it's a suburb of Nashville. And the reason why I'm here is because the associate pastor that I had up there has a sister that goes here. And so he asked her, and she asked me, and I said, okay. So that's why I'm here today. My wife is with me. She's still at the hotel. She'll be here through the second service. But I do want to say, ladies who wore hats, oh my, I love that. I do love that, and thank you so much. It's good to see a church with hat ladies. Well, today, just to let you know a little bit about myself, that's what I was told to do. We have three children, my wife and I. Two of them have their families in the Nashville area. One who's in the Army is still down in the Tampa area right now. I've got about four grandsons. And I've been retired for about a year and a half. So if you have any other questions, hold it for later. Okay? Today, I also asked Judy because she sent me the regular lecture series on what it's supposed to be for today, but it's Mother's Day, and for years I use Mother's Day and Father's Day to talk about the family and how the Lord looks upon the family, our responsibility as family, all of this, and I feel especially that it's needed in this world that we live in today. We need to have stability in the family. And so if you don't mind, I'd like to focus on that today. I know some of you don't have children at home, or some of you aren't moms or dads, but this applies to grandparents, it applies to aunts and uncles as well. So I hope it will be worshipful for you. Now, I know it's you want to chat and all that, but right now, let's prepare our hearts and minds for worship. This is a time where we come before the Lord and we just celebrate him, we worship him. So I want you to get everything else out of your mind and leave the baggage out there, and let's just focus on the Lord, because he has done an amazing thing for us. He loves us. How many of you deserve God's love? We don't, do we? He loves us so much, even though we don't deserve it. And he wants us to be with him for all eternity. Go figure. But this is God's grace. And this is why we're here today, to worship him, to thank him, to praise him for what he has done for us. So that's where I want your focus to be during this entire time of worship. Okay? Would you pray with me? I'm going to just begin with that. Father, I thank you for the opportunity to come here to worship with these people. And I pray that your Spirit would work in all of our hearts, that we would open up our life to you and praise you in all truth and honesty, that we would thank you for being our God, our Savior, and that you would bless us in this time. Lord, I pray that you would feed us with your word, and that you would help us to grow in this faith and in this love for you. Work in us now, and I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, I don't know if you rise for the opening hymn, but if you do, please stand.
Thank you.
Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
If we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us.
But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness.
Now I ask that we all pause for a moment of silence to reflect on our sins as we prepare for our confession. Let us now confess our sins to God our Father. Most merciful God,
we confess that we are by nature sinful and unclean. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart.
We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We justly deserve your presence. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. Amen. My friends, Almighty God, in his loving mercy, has given his Son to die for us. And for his sake, he most definitely forgives us all our sins. As a called and ordained servant of Christ and by his authority, I therefore forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Peace. whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all. Let us pray to the Lord. For this holy house, and for all who offer here their worship and their praise, let us pray to the Lord. Save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord.
Amen. This is the feast of victory for our God. Alleluia. Father, in homes where there is young life, may they be brought up in your wisdom and in your love through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
The Old Testament reading is from from 1 Samuel chapter 1. The man Elkanah and all his house went up to offer to the Lord the yearly sacrifice and to pay his vow. But Hannah did not go up, for she said to her husband, "As soon as the child is weaned, I will bring him, so that he may appear in the presence of the Lord and dwell there forever." Elkanah, her husband, said to her, "Do what seems best to you and wait until you have weaned him. Only may the Lord establish his word." So the woman remained and nursed her son until she weaned him. And when she had weaned him, she took him up with her, along with a three-year-old bull, an ephah of flour, and a skin of wine, and she brought him to the house of the Lord at Shiloh. And the child was young. Then they slaughtered the bull, and they brought the child to Eli. And she said, "Oh, my Lord, as you live, my Lord, I am the woman who is standing here in your presence, praying to the Lord. For this child I prayed, and the Lord has granted me my petition that I made to him. Therefore, I have lent him to the Lord. As long as he lives, he is lent to the Lord. And he worshiped the Lord there. This is the word of the Lord. epistle is from the first chapter of 2 Timothy. I thank God, whom I serve as did my ancestors, with a clear conscience, as I remember you constantly in my prayers, night and day. As I remember your tears, I long to see you that I may be filled with joy. I am reminded of your sincere faith, a faith that dwelt first in your grandmother Lois and your mother Eunice, and now, I am sure, dwells in you as well. But as for you, continue in what you have learned and have firmly believed, knowing from whom you learned it and how from childhood you have been acquainted with the sacred writings, which are able to make you wise for salvation through faith in Christ Jesus. This is the word of the Lord.
Gospel according to St. Mark, the 10th chapter. And incidentally, I'll be using all three scripture readings today in the message. So it reads, "And they were bringing children to him that he might touch them, and the disciples rebuked them. But when Jesus saw it, he was indignant, and he said to them, 'Let the children come to me. Do not hinder them, for to such belongs the kingdom of God. Truly I say to you, whoever does not receive the kingdom of God like a child shall not enter it.' And he took them in his arms and blessed them, laying his hands on them." This is the gospel of our Lord. Please be seated. It listed a children's message, but I don't see any children. If there are, all right, we'll wait for the later service. Pray with me, please. Open our hearts now to you, Lord. Help us to hear you speaking to us through these words. And Lord, help help us to hear you not just with our ears, but to the very depths of our soul. Work in us through your Spirit, and work a change in us today, right now. I ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Folks, I think we'd all agree that Mother's Day is a day when we spend a little more time than usual thinking about our moms. Am I right? Even if they're passed away. I spent a lot of time already thinking about my mom. It's a day when we reflect on all that our mothers have done for us and all that they mean to us in order that we might honor them and that we would give thanks to God for that. That's the kind of day it is. And I personally feel this is extremely important for us to do, especially because we live in a society today that tends to denigrate and diminish the roles of mothers, and for that matter, fathers, and even the family itself. Folks, let's face it. We live in a world that is not of God. It's a world that does indeed hate God, hates the Lord, and it hates those who follow him, as Jesus told us plainly in the Gospels. It's a society that teaches morals and values that are just totally contrary to God's word and his will. And I'll just give you a few examples here. I see you've got some frowns on your face. I don't mean to do that. But what about couples today? They're encouraged to live together outside of marriage, not being married. That's part of our society. I'm sure you know folks like that. It's commonplace today. Or homosexuality. That has been normalized. It's been accepted, and it's even celebrated. That's in our society today. Abortion has become commonplace with us. It's just everybody knows it. It's a form of birth control nowadays. And biblical distinctions between men and women are getting a little blurry today, aren't they? There are those who are trying to erase those distinctions, as we have seen with that transgender issue that's bombarding us lately. Children are exposed to sexual content and sexual activity at a much, much younger age. All they gotta do is turn on the TV or go on the internet or have a drag queen come to their elementary school and teach the kids. I mean, I'm not telling you lies. These are things that are happening. And parents, this is one of the most upsetting things to me, parents are being pressured to delegate the moral training of their children to the schools and to the government. Now, I'm just scratching the surface here, so let me put it as simply as I possibly can. This society is totally confused about manhood, womanhood, sexuality, about the family, about parenting. And when a Christian looks to the Bible for direction and guidance, they look to the Bible for God's will and purpose for the family, they are dismissed simply as being outdated, they're old-fashioned, out of touch, or even worse, they're considered to be intolerant or closed-minded, even hateful. Have I depressed you yet? I don't mean to. It's my first visit with you, but I don't mean to do that. But I just wanted to show you the reality of the culture that we live in today. It's a culture that really makes parenting extremely difficult. And that's why I believe what is so needed in the family today is just simply stability. A stability that comes from a mom and a dad whose trust in Jesus as Lord and Savior is strong, and who out of that faith, they actively bring their children to the Lord, just as Jesus commanded in that gospel reading today. Remember what he said? You're all familiar with that one. He turns to his disciples and says, "Let the children come to me. Do not hinder them, for to such belongs the kingdom of God." There it is, right there. We are called upon to bring our children to the Lord. Now, I want to emphasize something here, and that is that bringing our children to the Lord is the greatest responsibility, the most important job that we could ever have as a parent, and for that matter, as grandparents and aunts and uncles and other family members. Now, why is that? It's because the kingdom of God belongs to our children, and they really to know about that, especially today. Just think about this for a second. I'm going to try to lift you up a little. The kingdom of God is really all about grace, isn't it? I mean, that unbelievable, unconditional, amazing love that God has for us. It was this grace that, of course, brought Jesus into this world. And it brought him to that cross, where he paid that very, very high price of laying down his own life to buy us, to purchase our freedom from our slavery to sin, to death, to hell, to Satan. Folks, I don't know how often you think about it, but hey, Jesus bled and died there for us because he really does want you and me to be with him for all eternity. He bled and died there for us because he wants us to know God. He wants us not just to know about him, but to know him, to know his presence in our life, to know his love, to know his forgiveness, his peace, his joy. Jesus bled and died for us on that cross so that we might become part of his family and have a relationship with him right now and for all eternity in heaven. And I want you to understand something here. Jesus didn't go through all of that just for the world, just for everyone else. Now, I know, we all know John 3:16, right? For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. And he does. But folks, I've come across so many people who believe that passage in John 3:16, but they don't believe that God could forgive them because they did too much. I have a son in who's a Green Beret who for the longest time said to me, Dad, he cannot forgive me, not after what I've done. And there's so many. I've had so many people like that. And you probably know people like that, right? And there may even be someone here in this room right now. And if so, if there is someone here, then I say this from the bottom of my heart, knock it off. And I'm serious, just knock it off. Jesus didn't go through all of that for everyone else. He went through it for you. Because whether you realize it or not, he loves you more than anyone in this world could ever possibly love you. That's grace. That's God's grace. And that grace is real. This is not just a teaching or a doctrine. This is not just a religion. This is a relationship that is very real, and it's a very close relationship that we have with the Almighty God. In fact, and I'm sure you're aware of this, but since I don't know you, I'm going to share this with you. Scripture tells us in several places that because of what Jesus accomplished for us on that cross and through his resurrection, that we can now, all of us who believe, we can now come before the Almighty God, the creator of everything that exists, both seen and unseen, and we can call this Almighty God Abba. Abba is Aramaic. It literally means daddy, not father. It's the more personal. It means daddy. This is the kind of relationship that our Lord offers to us, and he offers it to our children as well. And that's why we desperately need to bring our children to the Lord. They need to know him. They need to know God, not just as a teacher. They need to know him as their dad. All right, so how do we do this? Well, Scripture in many places tells us how, but today I want to especially focus on that 1 Samuel passage, because I think Hannah gives us some good hints in how we can do this. Now, do you remember the story of Hannah? What happened with her? For the longest time, she could not bear any children. And in that culture, the Hebrew culture, that was kind of looked down upon because she was thought of as not being whole. And Hannah believed it really was a curse on her. So what I want to do, I want to read just a few verses preceding that Old Testament reading that we had earlier. This is just a little before it, because I want to show you what Hannah was experiencing, what she was going through. I'm picking it up at verse 10. And it reads, she was deeply distressed and prayed to the Lord and wept bitterly. Now, I want you to try to picture that. She wept bitterly. In other words, she was crying uncontrollably. And in fact, the priest who was there, Eli, who witnessed this, he thought she was drunk because she was just absolutely hysterical over this. She wasn't, but This is how it affected her. It goes on to say, and she vowed a vow and said, O Lord of hosts, if you will indeed look on the affliction of your servant. See how she viewed it? It was an affliction. If you would look on the affliction of her servant and remember me and not forget your servant, but will give your servant a son, then I will give him to the Lord all the days of his life, and no razor shall touch his head. Now again, since I don't know if you know what it meant, the no razor touching his head, it's simply back then, again, in that time and culture, long hair was a symbol of dedication and service to the Lord. This was simply part of the Nazarite vow, which is an entirely different topic. But getting back to Hannah, Hannah made this promise to the Lord that if the Lord gave her a son, that she would give him back to the Lord. In other words, what she's saying here is that she would dedicate her son to serve the Lord for his whole life. Now, when Samuel was born, Hannah did not forget that promise. After Samuel had been weaned, which means he was roughly 3 to 4 years of age, she brought him to Eli the priest. And this is what she said. We read it earlier, but I want to read it to you again. She says, Oh, my Lord, as you live, my Lord, I am the woman who is standing in your presence, praying to the Lord. For this child I prayed, and the Lord has granted my petitions that I made to him. Therefore, I have lent him to the Lord. As long as he lives, he is lent to the Lord. Okay, now that word lent in the Hebrew is sha'al, and it's usually translated as to lend or to dedicate or to give. So what Hannah is really saying here is that her son now belongs to the Lord. That she dedicated him to the Lord, she gave him, she lent him to the Lord. So Samuel belongs to the Lord for his whole life. All right, let me ask you something. And I do like the congregation to participate, so I want you to respond to this. Did your mom or dad ever make such a vow to the Lord concerning you? Or parents, have you ever made such a vow to the Lord concerning your children? Now, respond to that. Anybody?
Yes.
You did? When?
Baptism.
There you go, baptism. You guys are sharp. All right, hopefully you've done a lot more. But in baptism, think about this. In baptism, all of us who were baptized into Christ Jesus, we've been, as Romans 6 tells us, we've been baptized into his death, his burial, his resurrection. In other words, we've been baptized into everything that Jesus accomplished for us through his saving work and his resurrection. Okay? That means forgiveness of sins, restoration of God, life that's never going to end, heaven. I mean, you got it. This is everything. We've been baptized into it. It's become ours, not because of us, but because we have been tied to it through Jesus. Okay? Also, another place it talks about in baptism how we clothe ourselves with Christ. We wrap him around us. He's so close to us. All right. So in our baptism, which usually was as an infant, maybe older for some, but in our baptism, our parents made that vow to the Lord, that they were dedicating the Lord. They were going to dedicate them to serve the Lord, in that they were going to raise him or her in the faith. They were going to bring them up so that they could get to know the Lord and know everything that Jesus has given to them. All right? That's what I mean about making this vow. And that was their responsibility. Well, do you understand this fully? And parents especially, do you understand what Hannah understood? All of this is saying that your children, even though they're your children, they're really not your children. They belong to the Lord. After all, you lent them, you gave them, you dedicated them to the Lord in your baptism. So they belong to the Lord. Now think about it. You know, the truth is that we have been blessed by God. He has given us this wonderful gift of grace in giving us children, hasn't he? Wouldn't you agree? They are such an incredible gift to us. Now, I know if you have teenagers, you might not think that, but no, you cannot give them back. All right. But they are such a blessing and such a wonderful gift. My problem with all of this is that we have this gift for just a short period of time. They're babies, then they're small children, then they're children, then they're youth, then they're young adults, and it just goes, and it happens like that, doesn't it?
So your child,
Yeah, they are. They're still our kids, and they're still the Lord's kids. All right. During the time, though, that we have them, that short period of time, that is when we have especially the responsibility to bring them to the Lord, to lend them to the Lord, to dedicate them to the Lord. Why? So that they would be brought into this amazing, life-giving relationship that we have with Jesus. That's our responsibility. Now, having said that, most parents, whether they're Christian or not Christian, are pretty much alike. They really are. They love their kids. They want what's best for their kids. But parents who have a real faith relationship in Jesus Christ, they have so much more to offer their kids, so much more to give them. They get to introduce their kids to their Lord and Savior. The only one who brings them salvation, the only one who gives them eternal life, the only one who fills them with peace and joy and hope, the only one who gives them heaven, that's a lot better than anything in this world, right? In fact, nothing can compare with that in this world. This is what we got to give to them. This is the foundation upon which they can build their life, their eternal life. That's why it's so important for us to bring our kids to the Lord, to dedicate them to the Lord, to lend them to the Lord, to make that vow. Lord, I lend my children to you. I give them to you. I dedicate them to you for their whole life. They belong to you. All right, so in a practical way, how do we do this? Well, again, there's many answers to that. But what I want to do is I want to take a look back at the first century church. Oh, and by the way, I haven't preached in a long time, so I'm going to be long-winded. Okay? All right. We're going back to the old first century church. I don't know if you realize this, but the attitude in our culture today is very similar to the attitude of the culture in the first century, when the church first started there. You see, back then, Christians were highly outnumbered, very much outnumbered, and they were not the good guys. Now, today, people are shocked that people don't look at us as the good guys. And back then, what are they talking? We're talking about God's love and how we are to love everyone. So they're going to love us for it. They're not. They didn't love them back then. They didn't love us today. Why? Because they were not a friend of the world. Their beliefs, their teachings, their way of life was completely contrary to that of this world. And so they became the enemy of this world, very much as we are today. Again, I'm getting you depressed. All right, so how did they deal with that? Well, now this is the difference here. This is a big difference. And this is something we've got to think about. Just for one example, their worship, their fellowship, their teaching, it basically took place in the home, or sometimes in secret places, but in the home. And that means that learning about the Lord Jesus was home-centered and church-supported. Now try to hold on to that. Home-centered, church-supported, meaning that they learned about the Lord Jesus primarily in the home. Now, this was supported by the congregation of believers in that location there, and they were equipping the parents to do that. A perfect example is what we read about in 2 Timothy today. Timothy learned about the Lord Jesus through his mother Eunice and his grandmother Lois, didn't he? And again, Lois and Eunice, they were equipped by that congregation of believers around them to do that. So if, in terminology that we might understand, Timothy was homeschooled in the Christian faith. That's what happened. Well, today, we kind of flip this around. Remember, that was home-centered, church-supported. Today, it's more church-centered and home-supported. It's just the opposite, isn't it? Where we think of the activities, the programs, the teaching, the ministries take place at a certain place, a building such as this, or at least most of that takes place there. And the job of the members, the job of you guys, you support the ministries and the programs and everything that are taking place here. And there's nothing wrong with that. It's just the way it is today. It's just kind of reversed from what it used to be. And we get different results. This is one of the results of this. You ever notice people tend to church shop? Why are they doing that? Because they are looking for programs and ministries and teaching that meet their needs. And that's why they do it. Now, unfortunately, A side effect of this as well is that sometimes parents get lazy. They want the church to teach their children rather than them taking on this spiritual responsibility. But here's what we need to understand. As I mentioned earlier, we live in a society that is running away from the Lord as quickly as it can, and it's trying to bring our kids with it. Okay, I mentioned a bunch of things earlier. How about our universities? Most universities today take our young people and they indoctrinate them to the world. What's going on? The world thought, the world view, the world, everything that is worldly. They do that in major universities. Christians, if you look at that, a lot of Christians in a lot of the major universities are persecuted today in this country. Okay, they're blasted for being Christian. All right, this is trickling down to the elementary schools, isn't it? Where lately it's become more indoctrination of they want the kids to think what the world does. That's why drag queens are coming in there and this transgenderism stuff and all of this is getting involved. And it trickles down there. That is why, this is a big reason why, as difficult as it may be for us, we need to have that paradigm shift and become like that first century church in many ways. And what I mean by that is that moms and dads and grandparents and aunts and uncles and everybody, we need to work, really strive in working to bring our Lord Jesus into our homes, into our families, where our children can see him and get to know him a whole lot better, where he's more visible and more real to them. That's our responsibility. And that's what our kids need, because this is the foundation they have to have when they go out into the world. Having it done one or day a week or 2 days a week, whatever it is, at church, it just doesn't do it. They need this at home. Now, this really goes back to what I mentioned earlier about how the Christian faith isn't really a religion. I know that may sound strange, but it isn't a religion. It never has been. It never will be. It's a relationship that Jesus made possible through his saving work on that cross and his triumphant resurrection. And this relationship is real, and it's right now, not just someday in the future. And this is why it's so important for us to bring this relationship into our home, into our family. And there's bunches of ways of doing this. You know, just for example, how about making a commitment for you to read the Bible, having a specific time each day in reading the Bible? Now, why do you need to do that? Because you've got to get equipped. You need God's word there, and it really does build you up. How many times when you've read the Bible, it made you feel great and got you recommitted to your faith in a little way? So we need that. You need time for personal devotions every day. How about family devotions if the kids are home? Having family devotions. How about setting aside a part of your day each day to pray with your children? Or if you don't have them at home, to pray for your children. How about having conversations with your kids about the Lord? And not just the teaching part, but talk to them about what the Lord means to you, that personal witness, that all that he means to you. I mean, these are just a few things, but this is all a part of lending our children to the Lord. And what we're trying to do here, not just to teach them about Jesus, what we're trying to do here is we're trying to show them what Jesus looks like by having them see him in us, in our words, in our actions, in how we live our life, and how we love him. Okay? The definition of Christian, it has many different definitions, belonging to Christ, and following Christ. But there's this one definition. What it literally means is little Christs. We are to be little Christs for our kids. That's the kind of foundation they need. Now, for us to do this, we have to step out of that passive role. And we need to become more active in this. And we need to make Jesus more visible and real to our children and our grandchildren and our nephews and nieces and all of them. And I know this. This is what we need to do, because for so many years, this is what I did not do. And that sounds a little weird since I'm a pastor. But because I would talk to anyone and everyone about Jesus any time of the day.
But you know something? When our kids were younger, I would come home and immediately I would go into that passive role. Sure, I prayed with the kids, mealtime, bedtime. We had family devotions. But that was about it. I did not go and really witness to them and show them Jesus in my life. That fell on my wife, Kim, who incidentally did a fantastic job. She is a great, great mom. And she never lets me forget about that. But to be honest, I was an idiot, which is nothing new for me, if you ever get to know me. I waited so long for this because you know what? This is fun to do. And it not only builds up the family or the kids, it builds you. I mean, I can't tell you. Today, I'm always talking to my kids and my grandkids about the Lord. And not just teaching them certain things in Scripture, but talking about what He means to me and all I have in Him. And it's exciting. You know, and I told my grandkids more than once, I said, when Papa dies, that day that I die, I'm going to be the happiest man in all creation. They don't see people doing that, looking at death as being the happiest day for them to celebrate. People think, oh, he must be depressed. No, I'm excited. I'm all thrilled about what I have in Christ. I'm going home to be with him. I'm going to be in that peace. I'm going to be so close to all those other believers. It's going to be the greatest thing ever. And it is the greatest thing ever. And that's what I try to bring across. And hopefully I do. Because this is the foundation that they need, that Jesus is real. And as I see it, this is very much like the vow that Hannah made. And so I'm encouraging you to do just the same. You know, make that vow to lend your children to the Lord, or your grandchildren, or anyone in your family, to dedicate them to the Lord so that they can have it. It doesn't matter how old your children are. It doesn't matter if your children have children of their own. You and I need to make this vow. And what better way to do this? What better day to do this than on the day when we give thanks to God for all those moms that made and kept that vow? So that's my prayer for us today. And thank you for being patient with me. Would you pray with me? Father, we praise you for your son Jesus. But we praise you today for the gift of family, both moms and dads and grandparents and all of them. You have made us so much stronger in this world. And when we have each other and we have you right there as part of our family, we can have such joy and peace, even in this world. I pray, Lord, that you would work in the hearts of all of us and so that we may make this vow every day of our life. Pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. And now would you please rise as we confess our Christian faith together in the words of the Nicene Creed. I believe. Substance. before you today, thanking and praising you for all that you have given to us through your Son, Jesus. On this day, we especially thank you for the gift of Christian mothers. Father, please continue to give them a loving spirit and a constant awareness that their children are truly a sacred trust from you. Hold them close to you and give to them strength, courage, and a trust in you that grows stronger every day. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayers.
Father, come into the homes of people everywhere so that parents and children alike would come to know Jesus and love him as their Lord and Savior, and that they would know you as their loving Father. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayers.
There are so many in need, Father. So many who are hungry, homeless, lonely, without a job, fighting depression, fighting illness. Please, let them know your loving presence and let them know your healing power. And today we especially lift up to you Travis and Steve, Kent, Dan, Jerry, and Carol, Chloe, Jim, Wilhelmina. We pray for Charles and Jeremy, for Rusty and Leon, for Nancy and Ken, Martha and Phil, Allison and Leilani. Lord, we pray also for the family of Becky. She's now at home with you. And I pray that she's having, and I know she's having the happiest day of her life so far. So we praise you for that, but I pray that you would be with the family as well and bring them your peace. We pray for these people and remember them in our hearts by the power of the Spirit that you have given to us. And we pray that they would know that Spirit, they would know your presence, they would know your healing, they would know your peace. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
Father, I lift this congregation up to you as well as they seek a pastor. And I pray, first of all, that you would keep them strong in the faith, that they still be excited about the ministry, and that they would take their part in the ministry here to bring Jesus to those in their homes and in their community. And I pray that you soon would guide a pastor to them, to shepherd them. Lord, in your mercy. And we also lift up to you all those who serve in the military and are in areas of danger, as well as law enforcement and those who are first responders, especially our family and friends. We bring before you Jonathan and Amber, David, Victor, Tara, Brian, Anthony, Benny, Scott, Kristen, JT, Sarah, Jake, Daniel, and Zach. Please keep them safe and help them to serve with honesty and integrity. Lord, in your mercy. Into your hands, Father, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy, through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. You may be seated. Thank you. Would you rise now as we continue with the service of the sacrament? The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks and praise.
It is truly good, right, and salutary that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, Holy Lord, Almighty Father, everlasting God. And most especially are we bound to praise you on this day for the glorious resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ, the very Paschal Lamb who was sacrificed for us and bore the sins of the world. By his dying, he has destroyed death, and by his rising again, he has restored to us everlasting life. Therefore, with Mary Magdalene, Peter, and John, and with all the witnesses of the resurrection, with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and saying, by the all-availing sacrifice of his body and blood on that cross. Gathered in the name and the remembrance of Jesus, we beg you, O Lord, to forgive, renew, and strengthen us with your word and spirit. Grant us faithfully to eat his body and drink his blood as he bids us to do in his own testament. Gather us together, we pray, on that last day from the ends of the earth to celebrate with all the faithful the marriage feast of the Lamb in his kingdom, which has no end. Graciously receive our prayers. Deliver and preserve us. To you alone, O Father, be all glory, honor, and worship with the Son and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it. And he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, he took the cup after supper, and having given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is a new covenant in my blood, shed for you, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." As often as we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.
Amen. Amen, Lord Jesus.
O Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, in giving us your body and blood to eat and to drink, you lead us to remember and confess your holy cross and passion, your blessed death, your rest in the tomb, your resurrection from the dead, your ascension into heaven, and your coming for the final judgment. So remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
peace of the Lord be with you always.
Thank you.
because in the bread and wine, which is the body and blood of Christ, he comes to you, and he has forgiven you all your sins, and he has given you the strength to live each day for him, to serve him each day. And I pray that you'll understand that and take that with you. Now, would you pray with me, please? We give thanks to you, Almighty God, that you have refreshed us through this salutary gift. And we implore you that of your mercy, you would strengthen us through the same in faith toward you and in fervent love toward one another. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Truly give to you.